Hello everybody, my name is Ludovic Seffert and I'm a professor at the University of Rouen. Today I will present you about behavioral adaptability, the role of degeneracy in perception and action system, insight from the ecological dynamics framework. First, to introduce my talk, I would like to mention that performance and movement variability exist everywhere, but sometimes we don't see it or we can't capture it. And as an example, when we track the head of the swimmer during a race, we are able to assess the variability of the speed of the swimmer, cycles to cycles. If I focus only on the average speed for one lap, I can see an apparent stability, and I can conclude that high-level swimmers are stable when they swim lap to lap. But when I look at the variability between cycles, so within lap, in red on my screen, you can see that within a 50-meter lap, the speed is changing, notably due to approaching the wall and then to leaving the wall after the turn. So finally, if I come back to the initial question about performance and movement variability, you can see here that behind an apparent stability of the performance, we observe a variability at a micro scale. So to me, it questions the interest of looking at how people perform at different scales and how this performance is achieved from a behavioral point of view. So if you look at this paper, you will see that to achieve this performance, several ratio of the stroke length and stroke rate are used by the swimmers. They fluctuate between more or less 10% according to their preferential stroke rate used at the beginning of the race. Here, for instance, you have two examples of the management of the speed in two swimmers. So here is the first male. You can see that for the first lap, there is a linear decrease of the speed, whereas at the second lap, there is a cubic modeling of his speed, showing that the way they behave between these two laps is different. Same observation can be made for these female swimmers. Again, you can see that quadratic regression is observed to model the first lap, whereas a cubic regression can model the second lap. So again, it showed that when you swim 100 meters from crawl, you don't have a stable performance, but you can have a different pacing through the race and through swimmers. So those two examples question how this variability occurs and what does it mean. More broadly, it questions how skill acquisition and skill behaviors are achieved, because it goes beyond the question, how fast can you swim, how far can you jump, or how frequently can you climb? The question we raise in this talk is more about how people adapt to the constraints. And if you look to this very old definition of skills, you can see that skills is the product of speed, accuracy, form and adaptability. So the core of my presentation is about perceptual motor adaptability and what does it tell us about learning and expertise. A brief definition of adaptability could be that it means an adapted but also an adaptable behavior. Adaptable means for the future. Already in 2011, Arrojo and Davids propose another view of skill acquisition and propose to focus on skill adaptation. Adaptation to constraints means that an individual exhibits adapted and adaptable behavior, as I told you before. Adapted because we are looking for a functional variability in the behavioral structures, which are able to perform the same performance outcome. In the literature of neuroanatomy and cognitive sciences, it is called degeneracy or multistability, which means many structures for one function. For instance, you can see here an interesting example where with different pens, you can write the same letters. So different structure for one function. But we are also looking for adaptable behavior, which could be defined as one behavioral structure which can exhibit innovation, creativity, and reach new outcomes. In that case, it corresponds to pluripotentiality or multifunctionality. And we can summarize this relationship as one structure who can achieve many functions. And the hypothesis is degeneracy could be the platform to develop pluripotentiality. So if you learn to use many structures to achieve one function, then you can expect that one structure will enlarge its initial function to achieve many functions. For instance, here you can see that with the pen, you can write letters, you can draw, but you can also attach your hair as a woman does. So adaptability is the sum of adapted and adaptable behavior, which could mean flexibility, so functional variability when it's needed, but also stability when it's needed. So finally, adaptability doesn't mean that we must be flexible all the time, but only flexible when it's needed and stability when it's needed. This relationship between flexibility and stability reflect the decision-making process. More than degeneracy, experts are able to exhibit creativity to reach new outcomes. So what I presented previously, which is pluripotentiality. So the hypothesis I gave you is that the fact degeneracy supports plurifunctionality. And we can achieve that by searching for adapted behavior because it would lead to develop adaptable behavior. Being able to use various behavioral solutions for a given task goal would lead us to increase the functional range of a behavioral pattern. So there is an interest to develop degeneracy in our athletes. From there, the second point of my presentation is going to be about how to favor the exploitation of degeneracy and pluripotentiality in perception and action system. I will give you several suggestions. The first one is by setting metastable regime of performance. When performing in transition regime, when exploring a rich landscape of affordances, and when safe exploration is encouraged. The second proposition I will do is by extending the athlete's maximal action capability. The third one is by pushing athletes out of their comfort zone, using, for instance, the constraints-led approach to prohibit patterns pre-existing in the repertoire or to temporarily perturbing their routines. And then, fourth possibility, by teaching to exploit environmental resources rather than by teaching expert techniques. So if I come back on the first proposal I made by setting metastable regime of performance, first I would like to define what is metastability. And metastability can be defined as a simultaneous production of two opposing tendencies. The tendency of several components to couple, we call that an integrative tendency, and the tendency of these components to each express their individual behavior, and we call that a segregative tendency. So we have a tendency to be coupled and a tendency to be separated. And those two tendencies, which are opposite, collaborate. So metastability formalizes the balance between the phases of order and disorder in a complex system, because the system tends to maintain its own structure, but also to transit toward new behavior. Therefore, metastability is a transient state, an intermittency regime of performance, where attractiveness exists, but no attractors, strictly speaking. So the system is attracted to a new behavior, but which are not represented attractors at the current state. Here is an example of how, in the past, some authors set metastable regime of performance or discover this kind of regime of performance. As you can see, when you change the distance of these AV bags that the boxer has to box in, you can see that when the bag is close to the boxer, it can perform hook, but when the bag is very far, the boxer cannot hit it anymore. When the bag is closer to the boxer, it can perform jabs, and you can see that for this critical distance scale to the boxer size, arm size, there are three kind of movement that can be performed: the uppercut, the hook, and the jab. So it's very interesting, because this metastable regime of performance makes the boxer very unpredictable if he's able to maintain this distance between him and his opponent. So here is a good illustration of degeneracy, because you have three kind of structures who are coexist to achieve the same function, which is punching the bag. A second example of metastability who demonstrates the existence of degeneracy is this example in cricket by Ross Pinder. So where the thrower throw the ball at a certain distance, and when the ball bounces very far from the batter, a front foot shot is used. When the ball bounces very close to the batter, a back foot shot is used. And then when the ball bounces in this critical region, the batter can use either the back foot shot or the front foot shot. So again, it means that in this metastable regime of performance, degeneracy exists, as the batter can use two structures to hit the ball. Finally, the last example about how we can set metastable regime of performance is the one by proposed by Eric Rietveld with his beautiful architecture called the end of sitting. So Eric Rietveld is known to for his paper about rich landscape of affordances, published in 2014, inviting people to switch between different behavioral patterns. Here in this building, you can see people who behave in a different way. And the end of sitting does not offer a position that affords working comfortably in a quasi-motionless way for hours and hours, like office chairs typically do. But here you can see that each position offers temporary comfort. It is comfortable, but not too comfortable. So in the end of sitting, once one legs will get tired about 30 minutes or an hour, and the person will switch to one of the many other positions, the landscape that fits better with the current body state. Perhaps she will be lying down for a short spell or hanging with her arms over horizontal black ropes that support the upper body. So again, by offering many possibilities of sitting or moving or standing, this beautiful architecture demonstrates that individual use degeneracy, exploit different position to work. Again, there is attractiveness, but not attractors, strictly speaking. Last example of about how we can set a metastable regime of performance is by proposing a safe exploration. Indeed, we want exploration, we explore if this exploration is safe. Exploration is safe when backup or fallback is possible. So to study this, the importance of exploration during learning and how we can design metastable regime of performance who invite safe exploration, we made in this study three climbing routes, one with old proposing horizontal grasping, so like this kind of grasping, one proposing vertical grasping, so the hold can be grasped only vertically, and this kind of hold that we can define as a dual grasping. So it means you can use both the horizontal and vertical grasping. The point is, in this study, the intrinsic dynamics, so the tendency, the spontaneous tendency of beginners, is to use the horizontal grasping that we call face body position to the wall with a duck-like position of the feet. So that's the spontaneous behavior that exhibits novice climbers. When we look at expert climbers, we can see that they experience variety of body position and hand and foot position using a side body position like Cleopatra, and they use the internal and external side of the climbing shoes. So you can see here, this guy is climbing being side to the wall with his trunk and using the internal side of the left shoes and the external side of the right shoe. By doing so, is can roll as a door whose open and close. So rolling from one side to the other side. So we want learner, in this study, we want learner to learn this position, this vertical grasping position, by moving side to side with the trunk. If we give only this kind of hold orientation, if we design the route like this, we observe that the learner resists to use this position with the feet and the hand because they feel uncomfortable as the body is always rolling side to side. So to encourage the learner to use vertical grasping pattern, we decided to help them to explore this kind of grasping pattern by designing a route with two kind of grasping. And in that case, it means the learner can explore the vertical position, the vertical grasping actions, and if it doesn't work well, they can get a backup, a fallback solution, which is to use the horizontal one. Obviously, we put the foothold in a way that it encouraged the climber to use the vertical grasping pattern. So that's what we get there. You can see there that if the learner, when the learner used the horizontal grasping hold, the distribution, so one color is for one learner, you can see that he's mainly facing the wall. So that's the rolling motion of the trunk. So you can see that each learner is mainly facing the wall when the horizontal grasping hold are proposed. When we use the vertical grasping hold, you can see that some learners resist and are only one side to the wall, while some other learners are oriented to the left, but also to the right side. That's the case of the green, red, black, purple climbers. Only the yellow and the white one. So that guy's rolled his body to the right side and that guy's rolled the body to the left side. And when we design the hold, the route by using a dual grasping hold, you can see that again, some learners resist like the yellow one, but some others have a flat distribution. And for instance, the purple, the green, the red, eventually the black, showing that they use not only the horizontal grasping pattern being faced to the wall, but also the vertical grasping pattern being side to the wall. So those guys exhibit degenerate behavior because, again, they switch between different body position, facing the wall or being side to the wall. So that's very interesting to show that to encourage degeneracy to be exploited, we can design metastable regime of performance to invite people safe exploration. The second way of developing or encouraging degeneracy could be by pushing athletes near or over their maximum action capability in order to extend their action boundaries. So here is an experiment that we published recently where we asked the climber to estimate the maximum distance that the hold can be touched, grasp, or grasp to then move to grasp the highest possible hold on the wooden bar. So you can see here the wooden bar. So basically, the experiment is to judge the maximum distance this hold here can be moved on this sledge. And once the participant estimates the maximum distance he can move this hold to the left, then he has to achieve the maximal distance on this wooden bar. So he has to make a compromise, between long distance on that way for the green hole to then go to a long distance on that way on the wooden bar. And the interesting thing is that to achieve the same goal, so to reach a high point on the wooden bar, the wooden board, you can see five different behavior, five different sequences. One guy, so behavior number A, start with the left foot and then the left hand and then goes up. While the profile B is a guy who start with the left arm, then the left foot and then goes up. While in the profile C, the guy start with the left foot but then cross with the right foot to then go to the top. And profile he start with the left foot, then the the left hand, sorry, then the left foot, and then change his feet to have the right foot as a support to go then to the wooden bar. And finally, the more advanced behavior is the behavior D. You can see this guy is just swinging his body to start with the left foot, then the left hand, and finally he's again balancing his body, rolling his body until jumping to the highest position. So you can see here a beautiful example of degeneracy. So to reach that that bar, five different behaviors can be exhibited. So again, we want to show how those athletes are able to go very far and push their action capabilities. Because if I take the example of the profile D, this guy is able to go further away when he has to use this hold than when he has only to touch this hold. For instance, if you look at this video, you can see there. So it's over his arm span. And the only way for him to reach this hole is to jump. So you can see there, it's over what he can do if he has to touch only the hole. Another example can be observed in swimming. So again, we can push the athlete out of their comfort zone using constraint-instead approach to prohibit the pattern pre-existing in the repertoire or to temporarily perturb their routine. So the routine of the swimmer is to use this T. So you can see in the bottom of the pool, they use this T as the reference to initiate the tumble turn, the rotation of the head. So what we decided to do is to perturb their routine by drawing a T on this board and by moving away from the wall, this board. So we move away from the wall, the board at 30 centimeters. You can see that on this video, 30 centimeters or 60 centimeters. So that's the way we trick the swimmers by manipulating the informational, the visual informational constraints. And what we observe is that when we set the tee further away from the wall, the swimmers initiate the head rotation further away from the wall, which is quite obvious. But the interesting thing is that as they initiate further away from the wall, the rotation, they have to compensate by changing the rotation itself. So we can observe two kinds of two patterns. One is initiating the rotation by using no arms, so just by the head, while in that case you can see that the swimmer initiate the rotation by using one arm. So again, we can see that when we push the swimmer out of their comfort zone by changing the visual information that we provide them to do the tumble turn, then they have to compensate and to exhibit degeneracy to different structure to achieve the same goal. So to achieve the tumble turn. We can also push the athlete out their comfort zone. So another example in swimming, by asking them to swim by gliding the maximum or the minimum they can. And again, you can see that when we assess the coordination between arms, so the lag time between the left and right propulsion, we can assess the coordination of the swimmer. So when there is no lag time, we call that an opposition mode. When there is a lag time, we call that a catch-up mode, and this index is negative. And when we observe an overlap between the two propulsion, we call that a superposition mode, and the index of coordination is positive. So when we fix a given, when we fix the swim speed, we observe that the swimmers adapt differently their coordination. Some swimmers in blue are able to glide a lot more than when they swim spontaneously. So you can see the index is a lot more negative. While some other swimmers in the maximum glide condition are not able to vary very near what they can do spontaneously. And when always with the same fixed speed, we ask them to swim the minimum they can, again, they can vary more or less 3%. So you can see these swimmers is always performing the same. Swimmer number four, 20, minus 21, minus 21, minus 21. And in comparison, we have some other swimmers who are able to vary a lot. So these swimmers, minus 15, can glide a lot more, minus 24. And when we ask him to reduce the glide, he's not able to do what he did spontaneously. So here, we can assess the absolute range of flexibility for each swimmer. And again, you can see that some swimmers are less flexible than others, showing that degeneracy is something that could be exploited by everybody, but not with the same range. Not everybody is able to rearrange the structure and to diverse his coordination. Interestingly, in this example, when we ask swimmers to swim with the maximum glide, if they want to follow the fixed speed, they exhibit some very unexpected lead big kick, in particular 8 or 10 kicking action of the legs for one arm cycles, which is completely unusual for swimmers who usually swim with 2, 4, or 6 leg big kicks. So again, it showed that when you ask people to, you constrain them, you can observe, when you push them out of their comfort zone, you can observe a kind of creativity. In particular, this kind of leg pick kick that we observe very rarely in competition. Last point, we can develop degeneracy by teaching to exploit environmental resources rather than teaching an expert techniques. So again, degeneracy is not something that we can oblige. It's something which emerge from our interaction with the environment. For instance, in climbing task, again, in ice climbing, climbers often use the ice axis as an armor to create holes. By doing so, they do swinging actions. But they could also use the ice axis to hook existing holes in the icefall, and in that case, they are doing hooking actions. So, interestingly, we can see that they can use the same coordinative structure to achieve different functions, swinging or hooking actions. It means that more than degeneracy, experts are able to exhibit creativity or innovation. Because they are able to exploit new opportunities that we call pluripotentiality. I can show you this beautiful video where you can see here that is swinging the ice axe with the arm, with the left on the right side. But when a hole exists, you have seen just now that is just hooking the hold. So again, with the same coordination, so an asymmetric coordination between the right and the left side, so you can see how the two arms alternate. Sometimes the climber is using a swinging action, and sometimes it's just the hooking actions. So it shows beautiful, in a beautiful way, how they use existing holds or create holds. To conclude, my take-home message would be, also degeneracy in neurobiological system invites coaches and instructors to extend the number of coordination patterns in the motor repertoire. Expertise further relates to decide for the most appropriate coordination pattern for a given task goal and relates to adaptability. So what we showed previously, it's not to develop and to enlarge the repertoire in absolute way, but to enlarge it according to the task goal that we want to achieve. So related to the function that we want to achieve. In that way, by extending the number of patterns in association, so in relation with the function that we want to achieve, degeneracy can support plurifunctionality, because searching for adapted behavior would lead to develop adaptable behavior, so for a future task. Being able to use various behavioral solutions for a given task goal would lead to increase the functional range of a behavioral patterns. And that's just a fun example to how we can enlarge the range of what we can do. Thank you for your attention.